Associate Pastor Amanda Redwood is coming with a word today, and I know she'll challenge you, and she will bless you with that word. So let's be ready to receive that.
Amen.
Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning. It's lovely to see you all. I mean, standing up there seeing all your backs, it's nice to see all your faces. Don't you love worshipping the Lord? You just really sense God's presence here amongst us this morning, and really, really just sense His love. You know how He loves you. He loves you so much. You're so precious to Him. So precious. And the last time I was up here, which was a few weeks ago now, those that were here remember I spoke about how God loves us and the importance of how He loves us. And knowing is the importance of knowing that He loves us. And as I knew I was preaching today and praying about it and thinking about it, and of course we've had Easter, and so I've been reading the events that happened around Jesus' death and resurrection, and I came to Peter's life, and I'm pretty sure last Easter Peter's life also really grabbed me, and it really grabbed me again this year. It tells the story of how Peter is standing by the fire and Jesus is being mocked. And Peter goes, "I'm not he." He said, "I'm not he. I'm not one of the disciples. No, it's not me." The question came again. "You are. You're one of the disciples. You're a follower of Jesus. You know him. You've been with him." "I don't know him. I don't know what you're talking about." "No, not me." "Yes, you are," someone explained. "You was with him in the olive grove." "No, that wasn't me." And Peter began to pour curses down upon him, and he swore, "I don't know this man. I don't know what you are talking about." The cock crowed. And in that moment, Peter remembered. He had said just a day before that even if he had to die with Jesus, he would never disown him. Never. But now, shame struck Peter to the core, and he ran out to the courtyard and he wept bitterly. You know, if I put myself into Peter's position, I wonder if I would have done anything differently. It's easy to say all kinds of things when life is good, isn't it? It's easy to say, "Yeah, I will stand for Christ no matter what," when the blue sky is and the sun is shining and everything's so wonderful. But then as soon as trouble arises, as soon as we are faced with the reality of the true situation, well, it's then that we truly discover what really matters to us. Peter had followed Jesus. He communed with him. He fellowshipped with him. He ate with him. He lived with him for 3 years. But when it really mattered, Peter was absent. Jesus died, was buried. Jesus was left alone. And then came the stories of the empty tomb. The stone rolled away. The tomb was empty. Peter, having seen the empty tomb, being a witness to that empty tomb, was locked in the room with the other disciples. Fear and confusion was crouching all around them. Suddenly, Jesus stood before them and exclaimed, "Peace be with you." We're not told in that moment, or perhaps over that time space, if Jesus had had a private word with Peter. But as I look at the story, I imagine that they probably did, because Peter was so full of shame of his denial that I think that shame would have prevented Peter from going to Jesus. I think that would have prevented Peter from crouching away and, ooh, you know, just being back, being standing back a bit, being held back a bit, until that is Jesus came to him. And until that is Jesus put his hand in his shoulder and said, "I forgive you. I love you." To find comfort and possibly peace of mind with all the events that were going on that were so confusing, Peter turns to all that he knew. He returns to his fishing, his beloved fishing. But that night, he caught absolutely nothing. Here he is, an accomplished fisherman, and caught absolutely nothing. And then a stranger on the side of the shore shouted, "Friends, throw your net on the right side of the boat and you'll find some." Deciding to give it a go, Peter and his friends throw the net on the other side of the boat. And suddenly they were unable to haul the net in because it was full of fish. It is the friend. "It's the Lord! It's Jesus!" someone exclaimed. Suddenly, Peter, I believe, knowing that he was loved and completely forgiven, because he was then completely guilt-free, his shame has gone, he freely jumps out into the water and runs and towards the one that he loves. He runs passionately, he runs intentionally, and there he meets Jesus. Together they commune, together they fellowship, together they eat. And then Jesus says, "Do you truly love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." Again, Jesus asked, "Do you truly love me?" Again, Peter replied, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." Jesus asked again, "Do you love me?" Feeling the pain of being asked again, being put into question whether he really loves Jesus or not, Peter replies, "Lord, you know all things. You know I love you." Today, Jesus asks us that same question. Do you love me? Not me, Jesus. Let's have a look at some scripture. Mark 12:28-30. "One of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating. Noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked them, 'Of all the commandments, which one is the most important?' 'The most important one,' answered Jesus, 'is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind, with all of your strength.'" So often today when we talk about the body, we talk about the physical health, our mental health, our spiritual health, our emotional health, and we tend to compartmentalize everything. But to the Jews, in hearing this, they understood that what Jesus was really saying was that they were to love God with the whole of their being. And not just the whole of their being, but with everything that they've got as well. They were talking about the heart, which to the Jews actually meant the seat of your intellect, your will, your intentions. It's the heart that shaped your character, your choices, your decisions. It was driven you, it was your passion. The soul to the Jews expressed the whole inner self, your emotions, your desires, your personal characteristics. Your mind was also portrays your whole self, including your rationality, mental thought, moral choices and will, your inner feelings, your desires, the deepest roots of your life, and in strength, wisdom, will, strength, mighty and power. Not necessarily tied with your body, but also your significance in society, also your wealth, also your belongings. It was what you had at your disposal. Jesus very clearly was stating that we are to love with the whole of our beings, with the whole of our lives. Jesus quotes this from Deuteronomy 6, verse 4 and 6. Note verse 6. Actually, 4 and 5 he quotes that from, but verse 6 after it says, "And you must commit yourselves wholeheartedly to these commands that I am giving you today." You must commit yourself wholeheartedly to these commands that I'm giving you today. So I read that, I was like, what commands? And I looked back, and if we look back to Deuteronomy 5, we find the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments. And first of all, when Moses gives the Ten Commandments, God speaks through Moses and says, "Remember, remember, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt into the land of slavery. Remember." That's really important to remember. Time and time again, the people of Israel were called to love and obey God in response to God's clear self-revelation. The revelation of his love, his grace, his forgiveness, his faithfulness, his protection, his saving acts, and the list can go on as you read through the first few books of the Old Testament. It was after Israel witnessed the amazing saving acts of God, bringing them out of Egypt, bringing them out of Israel into the desert, that he gave them these Ten Commandments. He's saying, remember, remember the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt. Remember. And so, therefore, you shall have no other gods before me. You shall have no other gods before me because I am worthy of your love. There is only one true God. He is to be number one in your life. He is to be loved above all else. Therefore, you shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything in heaven and above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them and worship them. For I, the Lord, am your God, and I am a jealous God. God won't put up with any rivalry or any unfaithfulness. He's a jealous God, and he demands exclusive devotion to himself. He is to be loved exclusively. Not with a divided love, not with a half-hearted love. He requires our total and utter commitment with all that we have, our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Therefore, You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. His name is holy, to be used to bring true adoration for who he is. He is God, the God of unconditional love. And fourth, remember the Sabbath day, keeping it holy. 6 days you will labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath day to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work. The Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. One day a week, the Sabbath, which is set aside for the Lord, dedicated for loving him, dedicated for worshipping him, and for his service. I don't know if you've ever seen this before, but these first four commandments very much reflect this is how you are to love me. Love me. Love me. Don't have any other gods before me. Don't make any idols. Don't misuse my name. Keep a day for me. Love me. Because remember what I have done for you. Jesus, I think, was affirming. He affirmed these commandments. He was showing us that we're not to ignore them. He was showing us that we're not to be legalistic in working out these laws, as he condemned the Pharisees and teachers for doing, but in keeping these as loving him, as a way of active, intentionally loving him, passionately loving him, we are learning to put him first in our lives and automatically fulfilling all the things laws. Therefore, we to love with everything, 100% loyalty, nothing superficial, but a real allegiance to him. No half-hearted love. No longer living for ourselves, but totally and utterly surrendering ourselves to him. Complete selflessness. Setting aside all of our humanness, our thoughts, our emotions, our desires, and loving him with everything. With all that we have, and with all that we are. Impossible. Is it impossible? In my humanness, I want to shout out, that's impossible, I can't do that. When we come to the Bible time and time again, the Bible makes it clear that in our natural human selves, we do naturally struggle to love God. Left to ourselves, our natural condition is alienated from God. We're left to follow our own desires, our own thoughts, our own sinful nature without any hope. And we can sort of see that with Peter. You know, when it mattered, Peter found he loved and valued his life above all else. And I think if you really look honestly in your own life, I bet there are times when you can see and recognize how you have also made choices over Christ that has shown you that there is an issue in your life that needs to be dealt with, that there's something that matters more than Christ. And there's two reasons that we can struggle. There may be more perhaps you can think of, but one of them is that we have a heart of stone. And another one is that our arteries to our hearts are blocked. Let me explain what I was talking to you about as we go on. But first of all, if we know and we can see there are areas in our lives when we are not putting God first, when we are not loving him with our whole of your heart, what do we do about that? Well, first of all, Remember, that's exactly what God told Israel before he gave them the Ten Commandments. Remember, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. Let us remember. So, you remembered last week, and I'm going to remind you again. John 8:34. Very truly I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Jesus here uses the analogy of a slave and his master to make the point that a slave obeys his master because he belongs to him. Slaves don't have any will of their own. They're literally in bondage to the master. They have no choices. They do and obey what their master tells them to do. When sin is the master of our lives, we're unable to resist it. And in that case, that is when our hearts are hearts of stone. And that is when we need a heart transplant. But there's hope. Romans 5:7-8. I love this. Now it is an extraordinary thing for one to give his life even for an upright man. Though perhaps for a noble and lovable and generous benefactor, someone might even dare to die. But God shows and clearly proves his own love for us by the fact that while we were still sinners, Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One, he died for us. Also, I remind you of 1 John 4:9-10. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as atoning sacrifice for our sins. God loved us first. God loves us, and we are so loved, we are so precious, we are so valuable, we are so highly prized to God that he sent his only Son. He sent Jesus to this earth to die for you, to die for me, so that we can be set free from the bondage of sin. That we can be set free from the wrongdoings against God, so that we are set free to be able to love him and to follow him, our God, our Lord, our Saviour. Romans 6:18 says, now you are free from your slavery of sin, and you have become slaves to righteous living. Now you are free. You are free when you recognize that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. You are set free when you recognize that he loves you. And he loves so much that his Son died for you. Once we come to that place of recognizing God's love, of recognizing what he has done for us, then the Holy Spirit comes. God sends the Holy Spirit to come and live inside of us and our hearts, to come and inside. And it's at that point that he turns our heart of stone in what the Bible calls a heart of flesh. A heart that is for him, a heart that is God, come to that place of keep receiving his love, because actually we love him with the love that he's given us. Because actually in our own sinful love we can't do that. Our natural love is too. We have to allow him to come in, fill us with his love, and then we love him back. If you are sitting here this morning and you know that Jesus is your Lord and Saviour, you know what he's done for you, you know that he loves you, and you can say you love him, but you recognise, if you're going to be really, really honest with yourself, you recognise there's a bit of struggle there. There may be a little bit of me, but there may be a bit of... there's something in the way, and so often we can have poor circulation. This is something that so often in my years of being a Christian that I have really, really struggled with. Really struggled believing that God loves me unconditionally. And when I'm going through problems, it can sometimes be really difficult. I know I love him here, but here, really love him here. When life is hard, sometimes it shows what's really going on in your heart. And we can have poor circulation. Our arteries can be blocked so that we're having trouble receiving his love and we're having trouble loving him back. Because there's a bit of a problem there. Sin is clogging up those arteries. There's something there that needs to be dealt with. And if we're not careful, then sin and those areas can really grow and our love for God can really grow cold. We do love him and we do want to follow him and we do want to be wholeheartedly for him. But there's just something in our lives that keeps getting in the way. There's a blockage. There's something that is more important. As I found this verse, as I was planning this preach, I went, ouch. Revelations 2, 4, 5. Where God gives a damning report to the church of Ephesus. But I have this complaint against you. You don't love me or each other as you did at first. Look how far you have fallen. Turn back to me and do the works you did at first. We have a choice. We have a choice that we can allow those clogged up arteries to continue. We can try and ignore it, we can pretend it's not there. We can leave him with a stone of heart and think, fine, my life's happy. We can keep going. And we have a choice to do as God asks here, to turn back to him. Turn to him to repent. Come to him and allow him to bring healing into our lives. Peter found himself sitting and eating on the shore next to Jesus. Peter, do you love me? The question comes three times. The same amount of times Peter denied Jesus. Jesus gave Peter the chance to voice clearly his love for God. He voiced it, he said it, he proclaimed it, and I believe each time he said it, Peter found strength, he found affirmation. Finally, he's like, yes, Lord, you know all things, yes, I truly do love you. Finally, he understood, yes, he does love God with all of his being. And he loves because God is so forgiving and so gracious and loved him first. Peter was reconciled with Jesus. Peter is his beloved. We are his beloved. And Jesus loves, and he's gracious, and he's forgiving, and he's waiting for us to come to him and to allow him to love us. Another part of remembering, I've actually already mentioned it, I've jumped ahead with my preach. You are loved, you are precious, you are valuable, you are highly prized. When I preached this a few weeks ago, those of you here will remember that I spoke about the 12 spies going into the promised land. 10 did not understand how loved they were. 10 didn't understand their value. They didn't understand that they were precious. They didn't understand. And because they didn't understand, they and Israel never went into the promised land. But 2, Joshua and Caleb, they completely understood who they are in God's eyes. They completely understood because they remembered. See, again, it's that remembering. They remembered God had already taken them out of Egypt. They'd already taken them out of slavery. God had declared it was going to happen, and it happened. God commanded, and he promised it. Promised. They obeyed the commands. God upheld those promises. When they didn't obey those commands, then Israel had to suffer the consequences. But then, in repentance, God revealed his grace and forgiveness. Caleb and Joshua, despite what they saw, despite the giants that they saw in the promised land and everything else, they knew that God is faithful. They knew that God loved them. And because of that, they knew God was not going to fail them. And that was the key to their hopeful and victorious spirit. And that was the key to their obedient heart. They knew that God loved them. They knew. To change our hearts, to deepen our hearts, to love God more, and I certainly want to love God more, to clear out my archeries, to clear out all that's getting in the way of God, then we need to be intentional about running to him. Just like Peter knew he was forgiven, I believe. He knew the grace of God. He knew God was faithful. And so he jumped out of the boat, leaving his friends in the boat with all that fish. Imagine. I tell you, I'd be in the friends in the boat. I'd be like, there he goes again. But off he goes running, because all that mattered was Jesus. All that matters. James 4:8 says, come near to God and he will come near to you. 2 Chronicles 16:9, for the eyes of the Lord range throughout the earth to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to him. We need to be intentional about loving God. Intentional about loving him with the whole of our lives, with our heart, soul, and mind, strength, with all that we have. Remembering what he has done for us. Remembering that he loved us first. Remembering his forgiveness and his grace. Passionately running into his embrace. And there are a number of things that we can do that can really aid us to passionately run into his embrace, that aid us to grow our love for him, to aid us to unblock those arteries, to turn our heart to a heart of flesh. And this is not exhaustive. You can probably find, add to this list by all means, but here's the list that I've made. We come to him passionately, intentionally, loving him through thanksgiving, through praise, through worship, again remembering what he has done for us. We commune with him, and I just love that image of Peter sitting with Jesus, eating, talking, fellowshipping. We talk to God, don't we, through prayer, but also we listen. It's so important to listen. We often pray, and we don't listen. We need to listen because God wants to speak. And also we act. You know, we communicate. When we communicate with each other, we act on our communication. Act on what God is saying to us. And just resting. We sang that song. Is it "The More I Seek You"? The more I seek you, the more I find you, the more I find you, the more I love you. But isn't there a part where it says, I lean back on Jesus, or I want to just lean back on you? Just that image, just lean back and just like, ugh. And just rest. Just allowing the Holy Spirit to just breathe. Just taking all the stress and the strain away. Bible study, so important. The Bible is our food. It's where we intentionally go to the Word to get to know God better, get to know his character, who he is, what he's done for us, and who we are to him. Obedience. Obedience, Israel. God commanded and promised. God acted. Israel acted, God upheld his promises. Being obedient to what God is asking us. Being obedient to his word. Being obedient as his children. I touched on this already this morning. Allowing God to bring healing. Wholeness. When we talk about healing, I'm talking about wholeness. Allowing God to heal our hearts, allowing God to heal the deep down roots within our lives, allowing him to touch. Maybe you're not quite sure, you know there is something there, you know there is a blockage, you know there is something that's preventing you loving God the way he desires, but you don't know what it is. Then can I suggest you pray that Jesus Christ will shine his light into your life and reveal it. Because he will, if you allow him, if you listen. And as he reveals it, you can then start praying into it with God and opening that area of your life up and allowing him to bring wholeness. He so desperately wants to heal your heart so you can receive his love more, so you can live love him. We can serve by serving him, serving those in our church, serving those around us. We can love God through our service, and we can learn to love God through serving others too. Being in God's church, being with the body of Christ, remember what the fourth commandment, remember the Sabbath rest. The rest, Sabbath rest is for God. It's not for we can sit at home and do what we want, but it was meant to be for God, coming together as a body, worshipping God together, listening to the word together, studying together, praying together. There are all ways of really coming to understand and deepening our love for God. And lastly, I've put on my list here, giving an expression of love. Giving, they can learn to love more. There's a real challenge here, is to think how much time and significance we give to these things. Being intentional to get to know God and his love more. Being intentional to love him with all of our being, passionately loving him. answer that question, how we spend our time doing those things, compared to other parts of our lives. I think it really shows us what really matters in our lives. Remember, God asks us to give him our 100%. So, we come to that question. Do you love me? And as you really think on that and really think, do you love God with that 100%? All of your being. Just remember what Peter exclaimed. Lord, you know all things. God knows how much we really love him. God knows our hearts. God also knows our desires. And my desire is to love him more and more. And he knows that. And I need his love to do that, because I can't do it on my own. I've tried and I have failed. I need to be intentional to go back him the first of my life. Be intentional about seeking him in these areas. Being intentional about allowing him to love me and getting so I can learn to love him more. Be intentional. Lord, I want to thank you that you have loved us first. if we don't know what that blockage is, Lord, will you shine your light to reveal that blockage? Will you shine your light to reveal to us what is the problem? Is it unforgiveness, Lord? Is it some undealt area in our lives that need healing? Is it a wrongdoing, a sin against you? Father, will you reveal it? Father, right now we lay it before you. Right now we lay that blockage at your cross. And Lord, as we let it go, we stand before you with open hands and ask that your Holy Spirit sorry that we have allowed ourselves to hold on to that blockage, that we have allowed it to get in the way of your love for us and for us to love you. And I really pray, Father, that right now you will cleanse our hearts, cleanse those archeries, Lord, sweep us. Lord, in the name of Jesus, of all that's not of you, sweep us clean, Father God, and open up our arteries to fully allow your love to flow in and out of us, Lord. To allow your love to literally penetrate deep within our very being. Lord, Father God, and allow your love to literally overflow so that we are able to love you and put you first. Intentionally loving you, intentionally.
Shut